Okay, and we are all set. Good evening, everyone. My name is Tony Brewer, and I'm along with Joan Hawkins and Kyle Kwas. I'm a co-producer of the Writers Guild Spoken Word series, a series that began in person 5 years ago. This is our fifth year, and for the past year and a half, we've been running it as a virtual Zoom event, and we're hoping that maybe later this year we'll be back together in person. But for now, here we are on Zoom and Facebook Live. So welcome. Thanks for being here. We are sponsored in part by the Indiana Arts Commission, the Bloomington Arts Commission, and the Bloomington Urban Enterprise Association. The Writers Guild at Bloomington wishes to acknowledge and honor the indigenous communities native to this region and recognize that Indiana University and the city of Bloomington were built on indigenous homelands and resources. We recognize the Miami, Delaware, Potawatomi, and Shawnee people as past, present, and future caretakers of this land. I have just a couple of things that I wanted to mention. So the Writers Guild is a 501c3 not-for-profit organization, and you can find out way more about them as well as sign up for our newsletter by going to our website, which is writersguildbloomington, all one word, .com, writersguildbloomington.com. Or you can find us on any of the multifarious social media platforms, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Also wanted to mention a couple of events that are ongoing. One is Third Sunday Write. Third Sunday Write offers all writers a chance to share in a writing community and to flex and tone their writing muscles through exercises and discussion. This is an ongoing online workshop, although it has met in person in the past and hopes to do so again in the future. If you're interested in receiving monthly prompts and having a friendly place to share your writing responses and read the work of others, email Shauna Ritter, and her address is on our website, to get invited to the private Facebook group. Again, that is Third Sunday Write, an ongoing workshop. And I think actually the only other thing I have to mention is our monthly business meeting, which is also meeting via Zoom Saturday, April 17th at 3 p.m. You can contact the Guild through our website or on Facebook to get that link. I'm thrilled for tonight's reading. Joan Hawkins, K.H. Brower, and Abegunde are all fantastic readers and writers. They are going to be reading from a forthcoming book, Rape Escapes, and Joan will talk about that a little more in a minute. I wanted to mention before we get rolling that next month we will be observing Asian Pacific American Heritage Month, featuring poets David Mura, Anna Liu, Danny Nguyen, and also have music by the fantastic vocalist Kyoko Kitamura. And we will also have a short Q&A after that one. excuse me. before we start with our first reader, I wanted to introduce our filmmaker for this evening. We're doing something a little different. Normally we have music in between readers sort of interspersed throughout tonight. But I've been wanting to work with Valeria for some time. And so we thought film would be a good way to incorporate her into our series. Valera DeCastro is a performance artist, butoh dancer, and works in non-traditional and contemporary theater. She studied music at the University of Brazil and holds an MA in Italian literature with a concentration on film studies from Indiana University. Her work is interdisciplinary and largely influenced by Mara Biocchi, I believe I'm getting that right, Mara Biocchi's innovative methodology of the choreographic theater of tensions. And she is with us tonight and would like to say a few words about this first film we're going to see, which is Mother Earth, Perdona.
Hi, hello. And I kind of can you hear me? Hello, and it's nice to be here. It's great to have the opportunity. I am very, it's my first time actually that I really somebody introduced me as a filmmaker. I am, I consider myself as a performer. I do love film. I did some productions recently with the COVID. It was kind of an easy transition to do and experiment more with the video art and the video performance. So the Mother Earth that we're gonna see, the first one, it's, was just recently in the festival. I submit to a festival, was accepted, and was the first Echo Performance Festival, international festival. And we had people from different countries, different continents. It was a very beautiful event online in Zoom. And happened in this last month on the 16th, 17th, and 18th. So anyway, Mother Earth, it's part of this, I would say that it's kind of a movement where we want, through the art, call attention to ecological and environmental problems. So that's what it is about. That is a subtitle for the lyrics for the song. It's from friends of mine from Costa Rica. I love the song. I love the music. And so was a very interesting project because I did all by myself. And believe me, it's more for me when I talk of this work, it's more important for me to talk about the process than the work itself, which I think it's self-explanatory. But when you watch it, also pay attention, try to guess how I could film all by myself and perform as well. So it's a challenge. And maybe I will talk a little bit about the other ones later so we don't stay too much with me talking. Thank you, Tony.
Quem eres tu? Na catre na caixa na caharinim? Por que perguntas quem sou eu? Mawota te cachebe na caharinim? Acaso tu não sabes quem sou eu? Tienes hambre. Y ninguan niño ubicará ya, tocno chupehachi. Yo soy el que te doy de beber cuando tienes sed. arit ate ulev, yo soy tu madre tierra. Tiki hegach pan avi kinakush, tenlo presente en tu mente y en tu corazón. Manik clemente peneleu, mayak sutukil.
That was great. That was wonderful. And that was Mother Earth, a short film by Valera DeCastro. That was fantastic. And we will have three more short films by Valeria in between our readers a little later on. Before I introduce our first reader, she actually messaged me just a moment ago and said, you know, you really should mention the thing that's happening this Friday, which is speaking of film, speaking of writers and poets and all that. So Double Exposure is happening virtually this year at IU Cinema. And very briefly, Double Exposure is a collaboration between the Jacobs School of Music, IU Cinema, and the Media School, where they have student films written and produced by student filmmakers that have original scores composed and performed and recorded by students from the music school. Normally, in normal times, this would all happen live. There would be ensemble in the orchestra pit at IU Cinema. They would show the films on the screen and live musicians would play a live score along with the films. This year, same thing is happening, except it's all happening virtually, so everything has been pre-recorded. The wrinkle and the reason I'm mentioning it is the Writers Guild was invited, members of the Writers Guild were invited to submit poems for Double Exposure this year. And so I believe all of the films are inspired by or based on poems, including poems by several Writers Guild members, including several here on the Zoom tonight, Eric Rinsberger, Tony Matthew, myself, also Patsy Ron, Dory Lynch, I believe Walt Whitman was one of the other poems as well. So that's this Friday at 7 o'clock. And again, it is a virtual event, and I will, while Joan gets going, I will put that link in the chat. But my first reader this evening I would like to introduce is Joan Hawkins. Joan Hawkins is an associate professor in cinema studies at Indiana University. Her creative writing has appeared in Fevers of the Mind, Sand, and the Performing Arts Journal. Her most recent book publication is William S. Burroughs' Cutting Up the Century, co-authored with Alex Wermer-Colan. The piece she's reading this evening comes from Rape Escapes, a poetry and prose anthology in progress that she is co-editing with K.H. Brower. Rape Escapes is organized around near misses, assaults that did not happen or that did not happen to the narrator of the story, assaults that did happen but were survived. And I think Joan's going to say a little bit more about the collection. Joan Hawkins.
Thank you, Tony. And Valeria, those were such beautiful films. Thank you so much. And that's a gorgeous film. I'm looking forward to seeing the rest of them. So Rape Escapes has been a long time in the working. Shortly after Donald Trump was elected president of the United States, I was on my way to class one day and my cell phone went off and it was Kaylin saying, "Oh my God, the pussy grabber in chief." And we then began a conversation riffing off of that and deciding that what we wanted to do was do a volume that gave women stories, but not focused in the usual way around victimization stories, women who were victimized by a rape, but that we wanted to do something different. And hence this volume, Rape Escapes, which we hope will be coming out. We're hoping to finally do the final compilation and get it to a press this summer. All of the pieces that you're going to be hearing tonight, all the prose pieces come and poetry come from that collection In Progress. I need to give a trigger warning. I know it's certainly in my piece, a rape is described. And I think all of us talk a little bit, at least about the trauma that comes about both for people who get away, as well as for the people that we observe not getting away. So just be forewarned and know that if you have, if it's gonna be a problem, you might wanna just kind of time it so that you can come in for the movies and go do something else that's a little kinder to yourself in the meantime. Okay, so I'm gonna start us off. I write creative memoirs, so this is a true story. So it's called Philosophy Lessons. The night Paul Thurman raped my best friend, he gave me a ride home. Or to be more precise, he gave me a ride to my mother's. It was so late, the electric trolley cars had stopped running. So my plan was to walk to my mom's apartment a few blocks away and spend the night there. Paul thought I was crazy. "You can stay here," he said, "sleep on the couch." But I wanted to leave. You see, Paul, Dr. Thurman, was the chair of the philosophy department at the state college I attended. And the thought of waking up on his couch, no toothbrush, funky clothes, the social obligation to make small talk over morning coffee was mortifying. I'd come with a group of philosophy students who'd worked all night compiling the department's fall course descriptions, holed up in Dr. Thurman's office, typing, mimeographing, collating, stapling. We'd been told he wouldn't be there. And early in the evening, it looked like he would leave, but then he didn't. And at the end of the evening, he offered us drinks and pizza at his place. So we piled into a couple of VW buses and drove out to Professor Thurman's. My friend Meredith and I made sure to arrange a ride home with a philosophy grad student who had a tiny goatee and a passion for Kant and who, we later discovered, worked for Professor Thurman. He, the grad student, had left without saying goodbye. That, we later discovered, was his job, helping with procurement. So we were suddenly stranded. That's when I called my mother, who offered to pick us up, but I wanted to walk and I thought the air would help us both, Meredith and me. Meredith did accept Paul's invitation to spend the night. "Are you sure?" I asked, just often enough to annoy her. "You can come with me, my mom won't mind." But Meredith had already stretched out on the sofa and she didn't want to move. By the time I started collecting my things, she was already asleep or perhaps passed out, the firelight flickering across her face, casting gothic shadows, a burnt out cigarette stub still in her hand. I tried one last time to wake her, but she was out cold and only shivered a little when I shook her shoulder. I remember Paul looking very fatherly as he told me it was better for her to stay there. "She's too drunk to walk," he said, "and I don't think I can carry her. It's all right. She stayed here before. Other students have stayed here." Whistling a little, he went in the hall and came back with a pastel armful of blankets. Together, we covered Meredith with a small pink and green quilt. Meredith was taller than me, but she looked tiny under the blanket. And I wondered why she'd never told me that she and Thurman were friends. "We weren't," she told me later. "We aren't." As for him, he'd always been so derisive of the Marxist students. Hard to imagine philosophy sleepovers at his house, feminists talking dialectical materialism with the department chair until the last streetcar had gone. But then perhaps his wife would have taken an interest. He used to have a wife. Are you sure you don't want to stay? Paul asked me. I have plenty of blankets. Positive, I answered. Well, at least finish your drink, he said, holding out the glass I'd abandoned earlier. The drink he'd made for me. A tall glass filled almost to the brim with vodka. A little orange juice added at the end for color. Much stronger than any screwdriver I'd ever tasted. And you see, we hadn't had dinner. That pizza was always almost, but not quite being ordered. No thanks, I said, shaking my head. What I wanted at the moment was some fresh air and a cup of my mother's hot cocoa. I knew she'd be waiting up for me, curious to know why I hadn't gone home. Well, at least let me give you a ride, Paul said. The neighborhood is not safe. We didn't talk much in the car. Chilly night, big day tomorrow. A volley of little phrases, just enough to take the edge off the silence. When we got to my mom's, Paul double parked and waited. But when I opened the door, he leaned over, grabbed my arm, and said, I just want you to know, I wish you'd been the one who stayed. Then with a little shove, he pushed me out and drove off, leaving me standing in the street thinking of every weird, creepy thing he'd ever said. That beginning of the term party, I didn't attend. Meredith told me later he'd asked about me and seemed disappointed when she told him I'd gone to visit my boyfriend. Oh, he reportedly said, she has a boyfriend. And that time Meredith and I stood in the hallway asking Dr. Silverman if we could write a collaborative paper. Hey, Jim, Paul, Dr. Thurman called as he walked past with two of his own students in tow. How come you get the pretty ones? And tonight when he stood behind my chair as I typed his course description and leaning just a little too close, asked about the perfume I was wearing. It suits you, he said, sweet with a lot of spice. My ankle hurt. Maybe I twisted it when he pushed me out of the car and I limped as I walked toward the sidewalk. When I got to the curb, I vomited. I tried calling Paul's house and Meredith's apartment several times while my mother made scrambled eggs. No answer. I rehashed the evening again and again while I ate, sucking in a sob every time I told her what he'd said. I wish you'd been the one who stayed. When I finished eating, she asked if I had his address. You'll never get to sleep tonight for worrying, she said. Let's go. Surprisingly, he answered the door. Rubbing his eyes, squinting against the streetlight, he told us Meredith was fine. She'd woken up and he'd given her a ride home. He had just finally gotten to sleep when we arrived. And then looking directly at me, he asked, why were you worried? What do you think could have happened? I didn't see Meredith in class the following morning, but she did meet me for lunch at the Mexican restaurant where we always ate. Big enchilada platters and a salad for $3, free Coke, and mangoes when they were in season. Perfect for construction workers and impoverished students. Meredith was sitting at a corner table when I arrived, away from the windows. She was wearing a black turtleneck sweater and jeans, clothes I had never seen her wear before. No jewelry, no makeup, very pale, with only her dark hair and sweater standing out against the white and blue walls. She ordered a bowl of soup, which she didn't eat, and a cup of black coffee. When she turned her head, I noticed that her lip was slightly swollen and her cheek was bruised. What happened? I asked, whispery, as though we were sharing secrets in class. She woke up after Paul came back, she told me. She didn't know what time it was, just that when she woke up, he was inside her. He smelled awful, she said, like that weird sick smell you get with a fever. After he climaxed, he got up, handed her a tissue, and went into the bedroom. She waited. Maybe 20 minutes, she guessed, because she heard the entire first side of Rubber Soul playing through the wall. When the house was finally quiet, she got dressed and walked home. She was still bleeding. Pointing to my own cheek, I asked if he had hit her. No, she said. She had fallen on the way home a couple of times. And no, she did not want to go to the clinic. And she did not want to file a complaint with the police. Are you kidding? She said. He's the chair of the philosophy department. I'm a hippie chick with an active sex life, and I was drunk. They'd rake me over the fucking coals. I didn't ask about filing a complaint with the school. There was no institutional way to file such a complaint back then. No disciplinary action that could be taken, as far as any of us knew. Women who had bad experiences wrote abbreviated tales on the bathroom walls, warning others. I imagined Meredith would leave such a warning about Paul. In her signature green ink, letters tilting a little to the right, "If Thurman invites you to his house, don't go," she'd write, even with friends, speaking from experience. A week later, she left school. "Where is Meredith?" Dr. Silverman asked me. "Is she ill?" "Yes," I said, thinking of Aristotle's sickness of the soul. "I don't know when she'll be back." It was a year before I saw Meredith again. She was moving from Los Angeles to Ukiah, and she stopped to spend the night. She was bright and jittery, all jangling bangle bracelets and beads, full of stories and plans that didn't quite make sense. My brother came by to deliver some chairs and stayed for dinner. We spent a mad evening, Meredith drinking brandy and telling my ultra-conservative brother that she wanted to go work with the Tupamara gorillas in Uruguay. He thought she meant gorillas and kept asking, "Like Jane Goodall? I thought you studied philosophy." Laughing and never answering his question, Meredith kept repeating, "Tupamara gorillas," as she reached for the brandy bottle. She passed out that night too. My husband carried her to the sofa, and we tried to make her comfortable with a pillow and a small blue quilt. Looking down at her, I shivered as the memory of that awful night reached out its withered hand. She left early the next morning before anyone else was up. I left an effusive thank you note on the kitchen table. She'd made coffee, she said, and nabbed a bagel. She'd call when she got settled. I never heard from her again. I tried contacting her parents, but they'd moved and there were thousands of Brennans. In recent years, I've tried searching for her online, Google, Facebook, Instagram. I even tried one of those we can find anyone services. No luck. And so we have never had that conversation. You left me there. You wouldn't come with me. The conversation I thought might mend our friendship. About 10 years after Meredith was raped, I saw Dr. Silverman at a reading. He told me Meredith's father had called him, had said Meredith was disturbed and a pathological liar, and he wanted Jim's help in having her involuntarily committed. Jim had refused. A few days later, I ran into Paul Thurman at Top Dog, Berkeley's anarcho-libertarian sausage place. Cramped and greasy with newspaper clippings, Emma Goldman quotes, and poetry scotch taped to the walls, it was an odd place to encounter a pre-Socratic philosophy don and rapist. He was seated at the counter with his back to the door, so I didn't notice him at first, and he did not see me. But when I gave the barman my order, he, this leather-jacketed man at the counter, sat up very straight and turned. Paul Thurman, a little heavier, a little older, shorter hair, but definitely Paul Thurman. "I'd know that voice anywhere," he said. "You're the one who got away." Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow, that was Eros and Psyche, a short film by Valera DeCastro. And before that, we heard JOAN HAWKINS reading excerpts from the forthcoming book, Rape Escapes. We'll hear some more from the filmmaker Valera DeCastro a little bit later. I think let us have our second reader for this evening, the co-editor of the volume Rape Escapes, K.H. Brower. K.H. Brower most often writes science fiction for young people. Her young adult solar punk series of novels imagines a future world in which her heroines and heroes actively regenerate damaged ecosystems across the galaxy. She is currently pitching a new TV streaming series, also solarpunk, and is writing a contemporary feature film about a girl who rescues her neighbor's pet bull. Sky, I almost read pit bull. Her neighbor's pet bull. And together they save their forest. Among the Magic Mountains, her half-hour memoir, master's thesis, a film for USC School of Cinema and Television, has been screened at festivals worldwide, including at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. Escaping Beaver Trapper is her return to the memoir forum. Please welcome K.H. Brower.
Woo! Thanks, Tony. Escaping Beaver Trapper. 1. Depression, suppression. I've never thought of myself as a daredevil. I'm a bookworm and a story junkie. But that's me being naive about my own behavior. To be honest, I have a history of running wild, running a little too fast. I also have a history of depression and trauma and suppressed memories, like the 40-year-old story of how I escaped Beaver Trapper. I wasn't raped. I wasn't a victim. Or was I? I was only 18, and though not completely innocent about sex, I didn't know the slang meaning of the word beaver, the furry triangle that points the way to private lady parts. So, what brought this piece of ancient history to mind, an experience I'd survived and moved beyond without apparent scarring? A couple of things happened. I had a spectacular bicycle accident, and during my convalescence, I had a lot of time to reflect. The next year, a known child rapist and pussy grabber was installed in our White House. I crocheted a pink hat and rode a bus to the Women's March. Me too flooded social media. With each shared confession, my own memories bubbled up. I alternately choked on rage and tears as I unpacked the regular tiny insults and occasional horrific assaults. I am not a timid person. As a youngster, I rode wild and bounced back from every tumble and scrape. Nothing a little mercurochrome couldn't fix. Gosh, that stuff stung like the devil. How did we ever survive? I graduated public school in 1972. Most of my high school gang had chosen the University of Texas. I'd chosen a smaller liberal arts college. Just before our sophomore year, I rode with a carload of my friends to Austin to see what I was missing at the big university. But I had not planned how I would get back home. I don't remember how much cash I had. It wasn't enough for bus fare. ATMs and debit cards did not yet exist. But I knew how to hitchhike. Not that I'd ever done it before, but I figured it couldn't be that hard. Fast forward 42 years to another road trip on a glorious May day when I fell off my bicycle. If I'd had more experience, I might have been more cautious. Anyone who's ever ridden a well-tuned road bike in quarry country knows how quickly you can pick up speed just coasting downhill. If only I hadn't been seduced on Popcorn Road by the free-flowing breeze against my skin. I just couldn't slow down fast enough. Slow down fast enough. Was that an oxymoron? There was a sharp left turn at the bottom. Slow down, slow down, slow down. When I left the road, inertia and physics took over. I flew over the handlebars and landed on my right hip. No broken skin, but my insides were shredded. 2, the invisible wounds of everyday sexism. Looking at me today, nothing appears broken, and I'm shielded by all sorts of privilege, education, fresh running water, the whiteness of my skin. The only way I'm systematically kneecapped is by pervasive misogyny. I'm not alone. I see what the societal soup of sexism has done to my former coworkers and students, to my daughter, my son. I so desperately want to protect them all, but I cannot even protect myself. In 1973, a friendly old truck driver said he would take me as far as Waco. He spit chew, and that's a disgusting habit. Otherwise, the drive was boring enough. And the old trucker offered to help me find a ride for the next leg of my journey. He got on his CB radio saying he had a girl who was looking for transportation to Richardson, north of Dallas. Remember, before we all had cell phones, every trucker had a CB radio that connected him to every other trucker within 25 to 50 miles, depending on terrain and weather conditions. And they all had a CB handle, a code name. So after my trucker sent out the request, somebody responded that he'd heard Beaver Trapper was headed home, and he lived north of Dallas. The CB crackled. Maybe he could give the girl a ride. My driver chuckled, and I couldn't believe my luck. I didn't want to be out on the road alone after dark thumbing for a ride, and as improbable as it may seem, I had no idea the connotation of the CB handle, Beaver Trapper. I wasn't exactly pure, but I was sheltered, ignorant, and it was a different era. Texas Hill Country looked like Mayberry. Certainly, sexual assault existed, but it was whispered and renamed as something innocuous, like the standard excuse, boys will be boys. As I rounded my sixth decade, I'd run into a glass ceiling at the workplace, so I decided to focus on my physical health and reset my blood pressure. I trained with a group of long-distance bicyclists, all ages and abilities, everyone cheering each other on, and it was so much fun. I've never been in better physical or emotional shape. On Saturday, we rode 65 miles, my personal best, some of it through pelting rain. On Sunday, the sky was that perfect robin's egg blue with cloud puffs scattered around the hilly horizon. We'd ridden almost 50 miles, and we were on our way back to town. I was a little dehydrated, so maybe my judgment wasn't the best. 3. Questionable judgment. In Waco, the older trucker turned west while I climbed up into Beaver Trapper's cab. The seat was clean. Postcards and photos were taped everywhere, some of it pretty good. Western art, horses, bison, armadillos, and of course, jackalope cartoons. This guy, I do not remember his given name. Let's call him Trapper for short. He was younger than the first trucker. Not as young as me, maybe 30. And thank heavens he didn't smoke or chew tobacco. He was funny and easygoing in that Texas good old boy sort of way. He had a big mustache and long sideburns, a hippie cowboy, kind of cool and fashionable for the time. And it turned out the photos of cast bronze sculptures were, he said, his artwork. Really cool, that's what I thought. I still don't know if he was truly a sculptor who drove a truck for his day job, or if Trapper just gave me the trucker equivalent of, let me show you my studio. Because soon after we crossed the Trinity River and headed through downtown Dallas, he said he wanted to take me home for the night instead of dropping me off where I wanted to go. We were on the interstate going 70 miles an hour. How was I going to get out and get home? Inside Trapper's cab, I pressed as far to the right as I could go, with the window rolled down, letting the summer air whip my long blonde hair into knots. We sped past mirrored skyscrapers under construction. Trapper was determined to get me through the city and into farmland where he had studio space, and we could have a good roll in the hay. But I didn't want intimate contact with him, especially not in a damn barn. I went with my only weapon, words. I delivered an onslaught, mostly about how if I wasn't into it, it wasn't going to be fun for him either. I kept talking louder and louder, and then I started pulling snapshots and postcards off the headliner, throwing the armadillos and roadrunners one by one out the window. That did it. He pulled onto the shoulder, barely coming to a stop, and I jumped out into the dust and down the embankment. That's how I escaped Beaver Trapper. May 17th, 2015. I don't remember my short flight over the handlebars. I do remember yelling help. The shock was intense, but I didn't hit my head. I never lost consciousness, and it didn't take long for the riders behind me to catch up. Several guys in their spandex straddled their road bikes trying to assess how badly I'd been injured. I rolled over on my hands and knees to take the pressure off my back. I remember saying, "This hurts worse than childbirth," but I don't think the guys heard me. I didn't cry or scream, Instead, I talked to Blue Streak about all sorts of things, anything to keep my mind off the relentless pain. Fire consumed my entire core. I got quiet. Grateful my face wasn't in a patch of poison ivy. Grateful I hadn't landed on an outcropping of limestone. 4. The last time I'd been afraid. When I interviewed for a teaching position at a Big Ten university, the department chair and faculty were thrilled with my industry experience. My decade of regional, national, and international professional credits and awards clearly equal top-level academic certification. I was so proud of my new job. By then, I was a mother, my daughter, 1 year old, and teaching felt like a perfect fit. With a schedule I could control, and access to top facilities and an amazing talent pool. I dreamed of creating children's programming based on folk tales, one of many possibilities. I wrote grants. I was in conversation with HBO about a documentary idea. 2 years and one more child later, my department fractured. Enter a new chair who was less than enchanted with my value. My academic colleagues in the PBS member station next door failed to support me, every individual focused on their own careers. The last straw was when a student stalked me. He first attended one of my classes when I was visibly pregnant with my second child. Every semester, he took another class from me and always needed extensions for his work. His interest in me was less about sexual control and more grasping for a mother figure, but my instincts rang the bell loudly. He was dangerous. Other teachers knew him and laughed and shrugged it off. The Department of Women's Affairs couldn't help me because, as a professor of practice, I fell outside their tenure track purview. The new chair told me I was the one with the power, and it was my job to handle difficult students. There was no one to protect me. Meanwhile, I had nightmares of the stalker showing up with a shotgun, killing everyone in sight. I had to protect my two young children. So when my contract came up, I did not sign. After 4 years, I walked away from my full-time prestigious career to spend more time with my young children. Ashamed, I wasn't tough enough. I buried my memory of a student I couldn't control who stalked me and threatened my well-being. A couple of years later, I learned from the university ombudsman that that student was diagnosed with a known psychopathy. The administration knew he could have gone postal and killed us all. After escaping Beaver Trapper's cab, I called from the payphone at the ice cream shop near my house, and my stepfather came to pick me up. He never asked anything about who'd given me a ride or anything about my trip from Austin. Nobody did. Thinking back, it's odd I never talked about Beaver Trapper to anyone. I was ashamed. I'd been so stupid. So I forgot about it. Then I heard a political candidate brag about grabbing pussy. Soon after, a friend, Joan, told the story of her own rape escape, also at a tender, trusting age. My memories uncorked. After my spectacular bicycle accident, my healing journey has been slow. On the outside, I had one nasty bruise, but the internal damage? I'm lucky I didn't end up losing bladder control permanently or the capacity for sexual pleasure. Because when I fell, my L1 vertebrae was partially crushed. Add to that wound, compression fractures in T11 and L3, plus serious strain to my parasympathetic nervous system, internal organs, and surrounding tissue. For months, I was bedridden. Once I got the back brace, I tried to get out every once in a while because the isolation was the worst thing of all. And I hated appearing weak and vulnerable. I was in denial. I lost an inch in height and 20 pounds. 5, late stage career pivot, seeking connection. I've had multiple careers. In this third act of my life, I want things to be different. Rather than going it alone like a cowgirl, I'm taking my cues from the natural world. The way an ecosystem thrives and individuals within it survive is through connection. Take mushrooms and their underground hair-like mycelium, the vegetation from which the fruiting mushrooms spring forth. The fungal mycelium wraps around other roots, connecting trees to grasses to every growing plant in woods and meadows. It's how a mother tree shares water and minerals, supporting her young progeny sprouting from a nearby nurse log. Mother Earth shows us making connections is the primary experience. But this is a real flip for me in a career venue, so I'm taking baby steps. Rather than positioning myself as expert or teacher, I've become a student again. I receive assignments via email. I've learned to schedule myself with others, a screenwriting buddy, a couple of marketing groups, a website guru, a beloved mentor. And I've been taking advantage of a virtual writer's cafe. As I write this, I'm rubbing elbows via Zoom. We're each tapping away, listening to our own music, fueling each other's imaginations and energy levels. Every morning, 5 days a week, I'm not alone. The excellent work flows from our connections. 6, escape assault, defy expectations and assumptions. Every choice comes with some kind of risk. I choose to spend the rest of my days inspired by a community of visionaries and artists. Dance with abandon. Celebrate neurodiversity. Envision a just world. Thanks. Back to you, Tony.
Thank you. Thank you.
And that was Birds in Cage, a short film by Valera DeCastro. I've been calling her work kind of performance films because it's often kind of the filming of a performance, or even if it's not a performance with an audience, it's still a filmed performance, but wonderful, wonderful work. And before that was K.H. Brower reading excerpts from the forthcoming book, Rape Escapes. Our final reader for this evening, also reading from the book, is Maria E. Hamilton Abegunde, Ph.D. She is a memory keeper, poet, ancestral priest in the Yoruba Orisa tradition, healing facilitator, and doula. Her research and creative works are grounded in contemplative practices and respectfully approaching the earth and human bodies as sites of memory, and always with the understanding that memory never dies, is subversive, and can be recovered to transform transgenerational trauma and pain into peace and power. Her most recent works address anti-Black racism and violence, genocide, sexual violence, and healing in the U.S., Brazil, and Juba, South Sudan, and can be found in If My Body Could Talk, North Meridian Review, The Massachusetts Review, Tupelo Quarterly, Fire, and Keeper of My Mother's Dreams. She is the founding director of the Graduate Mentoring Center and is a faculty member in the Department of African American and African Diaspora Studies at Indiana University. In 2021, she was featured in Bloom Magazine in the February-March issue that recognized the accomplishments and contributions of Black women of Bloomington. Dr. Abegunde is a Cave Canem, Sacatar, Ragdale, and NEH fellow. Please welcome Abegunde.
So good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being here with us this evening. I'd like to thank Joan and Kaylin and Valeria for the readings and for the performances. Valeria, I don't know if you knew what we were reading ahead of time, but I feel that your work has really been matched, everything that we are talking about. There's an alignment. So I am going to read the middle section of a personal essay called I Want to Go Home Now. When the hashtag MeToo campaign rolled onto my Facebook page, I did not hesitate. I did not detail, but I did not second guess adding the hashtag and sharing that I too had been wounded in this way. When the invitation for this essay appeared, I did not hesitate. I didn't know much about anything else about it, but it sounded like the place that I wanted to be. I did not hesitate. It requires details, but I have become accustomed to sharing them. Here is one such detail about one part of my life that I always want to remember. This is my story. I was a freshman at a Big Ten university. It was my first semester. I had neither boyfriend nor girlfriend. I met men and women at parties. We went to dinners, the movies, or university events. These were often group activities, but occasionally dinner was private. The evening I am recalling was such an evening. Weeks before that night, I had started talking to a guy. Based on his interactions with those I was getting to know, I felt safe. Based on my life experiences, I was careful with whom I chose to be friends or intimate partners. As a freshman, I understood I had to protect my reputation. I trusted my instincts. So far, they told me this guy was okay. In addition, the grapevine and gossip tree had not revealed any horrid stories. When he asked me to have dinner, I accepted. When he suggested his apartment close to campus, I accepted. I do not remember if I told my roommate or anyone else where I was going. That evening, he came to pick me up. We rode the train together. The walk from the train to his apartment was not far. It was a warm fall night. There was no need for jackets. And although we did not know each other very well, we had been getting to know each other rather nicely over the phone. The conversation as we talked was light, the kind you have when you like someone but are unsure what happens after the first date ends. We arrived at his apartment. I remember it was adult in a way dorm rooms and off-campus university residents were not, clean, organized, a separate kitchen full of plates and glasses organized on shelves, a separate living room with a couch and bookcases, a dining table with placemats, and a separate bedroom. It was comfortable and welcoming, and it smelled good. He had started preparing dinner before meeting me. Tomatoes and vegetables permeated the air. Nothing fancy. Amazing, the things you remember. Our memories are shaped by so much, our peculiar pensions, what interests and surprises us, what causes us love and satisfaction, or what causes us fear and agony. We talked for a bit more, then he excused himself and went to the kitchen, leaving me in the living room to look around and relax. I was doing just that until I realized he was on the phone, talking to someone in a low tone that I would have missed had I not been sensitive to changes in sound. Something in his voice troubled me, and I began to pay attention. I heard him say, "Man, why don't you come on over here?" Then he laughed. My psychic and clairvoyant gifts were just emerging, but I suddenly had an image of the other person, bearded, older, also laughing. They were sharing a joke from which I had been excluded, yet I was the guest. My entire body tensed. I wanted to run. Instead, I remained on the couch and strained to listen to the rest of the conversation through the sweet smell of the food, the ordered space, and the fear that something was wrong and that I was in danger. Finally, he hung up the phone and returned to the living room. Give me one moment, please, and let me just change out something. There is a section, if you all would give me just a moment, I'm not sure what happened to the section here as I planned. Aha, there it is. I jumped off the couch and stood up and yelled, "I want to go home now." I remember that we were standing about 12 feet apart. I had to pass the kitchen to get to the front door. The kitchen had a window looking onto the street below. Could I jump out of it safely? Without breaking too many parts, he was closer to the kitchen and door than I was and looked confused. Afterward, I realized that I probably looked like a madwoman, yelling for apparently no reason. After weeks of planning that I wanted to go home. Yes, because I did not know when the other man would arrive, only that he would arrive. I was at that moment a madwoman. A woman willing to move fast and use violence if necessary, a madwoman with a super heroine ability to know that when the other man arrived, I would not be able to leave. "What?" he asked, like he wanted to slap me. "Who were you talking to?" I asked. "A buddy of mine." There was no mention of the invitation. "I want to go home," I yelled again and began moving towards the door. I didn't run. I didn't know if doing so would initiate any action on his part. All I knew was that I would fight him. He was taller than I was, but not bigger. For a moment, he looked frustrated, disappointed, like I had spoiled his evening. "I'll take you home so you don't have to ride the train by yourself." "No," I said. "At least let me walk you to the train." "Fine," I said, and headed towards the door as he returned to the kitchen to turn off the stove. The walk back to the train at the train station. We said nothing. I boarded, I arrived home, I breathed, I may have prayed. He didn't call. I never saw him again. Weeks later, I mentioned what had happened to a guy I would learn was one of his fraternity brothers. His response was so matter of fact, oh yeah, they have a reputation of raping women on campus together. I had apparently escaped what had happened to others and possibly saved my own life. All the men knew about it. And the women, over time, I would learn that the women were ashamed and shamed into silence. In addition, they did not want to get these young Black men into trouble. Pause, breathe. Remembering makes you say again, what the hell? Oh yeah, they have a reputation together. It makes you remember anger and how good you were at controlling it to save your life. An art form you would perfect into a diamond-edged blade to cut your way out of anything that threatened your life. Breathe, pause. Remembering makes you wonder how many women were unable to trust their mad women or didn't know they had one or were raped and killed, and the screams of their mad women were stifled, swallowed, unheard, ignored, buried, while they smelled tomatoes boiling. But I digress. When I read the call for submissions for this anthology, my dilemma was not whether or not to submit something. No, the question was which one of my stories would I share? How would I share it? For what purpose or for whom? And after so long, would sharing this story serve my communities and contribute to making us free and keeping me free? More importantly, would a story about a rape that was being intuited, not one where there was an overt threat of rape, be the right story to share? I was not, after all, touched or verbally assaulted or harassed. Would a story that relied on the narrator's own self-knowledge and intuition be relevant to anyone? After all, women, children, the underrepresented, fill in the blank, are encouraged to doubt what we sense, feel, and know in the bottom of our stomachs. We are deterred from making meaning of the raised hair on the backs of our necks. I chose this story because at that time in my life, aside from the precognitive and paranormal experiences about the death of my mother, there were few other events that told me to trust who I was becoming and the things I could not see. I am a healer. I tell others that their stories do not define them, but this story, unlike the actual rapes, abuses, and assaults that predated it, does define me. It is not because I was not raped. Does the word rape make you uncomfortable as you read or listen to this word more than once? Yes. Does this change how you think of me or might look at me when you next see me? Maybe. Are you trying to avoid feeling what you are feeling? No. But you know you want to. Are you reinterpreting everything I've ever done or said? Stop. Keep reading, please. Or perhaps my story is your story, and it makes you remember that story you want to forget. If so, close these pages now. Even take yourself away from this monitor. Breathe. Remind yourself, memory is not your enemy. Remind yourself, you are alive. Say out loud, I am alive. Remind yourself, someone wrote a story about what happened to her. Remember, there are more stories. Know this, the story you are remembering is yours to do with whatever you want. Then reopen these pages, turn your camera back on. Tomorrow, a week, next month, in a year, in a minute. Read or never open these pages. Never turn your camera back on again. Whatever your decision, it is your decision to make. More than 35 years later, I remember I recall, I tell, as I have done from the beginning. While I do not live with the story in the same way I live with the other assaults, and while this one does not linger in the shadows, occasionally disrupting an evening, forcing its way into dreams or conversations, this memory has not disappeared. Unlike the others, I worked hard. Unlike the others, I worked hard to forget. And very hard to heal, to put on the page so that they could be heard. This one I've kept to myself. I don't want it to go away, because even if you are like me and you have walked away alive from serial pedophiles, potential rapists, and actual rapists, there is no escaping what happened or what was allowed to happen. There is no forgetting that in the United States, one out of every six women has been a victim of an attempted or completed rape. Of those, college-aged women are three times more likely to be raped than women not in college. More than 15 million women. When you consider, and you must, that young boys and men are raped, and that Black, Brown, and transgendered people are at higher risk, you begin to understand the magnitude of this violence and its increasing impact on public health. But I digress again. This is my story. My story defines me. I want to remember it. That night was the first time I used my sixth and seventh senses. It was the first time I would challenge a man out loud with my voice and decide that the size and weight of my body were weapons to be used no matter what the outcome. It would be the first time I would always choose to fight by whatever means I had. It was the night I knew that although I had lived through all the other things that had been done to me, that from this point on, I had the power to demand what I wanted, speak it into being, and to live without fear. I want to go home now. That year, I decided I would tell all my stories to anyone who would listen. I would not publicly share them in writing until after graduating from college. When I decided to do so, I called an elder, invited her to my house, and showed her a full-length manuscript that would become what is now Unanswerable, my first collection of poetry. After reading the poems, here is what she said, more or less, publish it. I have witnessed this in my church. I do not remember what else she said about some of the congregation trying to expel the minister and others supporting him. It would be the first and last time I would ask permission to publish and make public anything I wrote. Since the beginning of time, women have been asked to keep silent, to let others speak for us. For those of us who choose to speak, too often our channels for speaking are blocked or removed. All of us have courage at one time or another to speak our truths before we experience the fear of repercussions. If we have pushed past the fear, we are then punished as if we are badly behaved children disobeying our parents, or as if we are criminals. The one thing, however, of which I have always been certain, for me, silence was not an option, even when it meant being called a liar or being blamed. I would learn this from Audre Lorde many years later. My silence would not, could not protect me. The other thing I know for sure, without writing, I would not have lived. I would not have understood the power of language to break silences about whatever we are told to keep silent about. Our victimizations and abuses, our family secrets, our chosen lifestyles, our loves, our desires, our dreams, our rapes, and the truth. Truth. Just like when I was a little girl, my community knew. And still the women were silent, and the men said, yeah, they have a reputation. They knew. You may think that I am speaking about this community only. I am not. That knowledge made me take an oath. I would not be silent about what had happened to me. I would not ignore what was happening to others. I would help others heal when possible. The healing is the hardest part. It comes with additional truths we don't want. Someone I thought I could trust. That people led me to believe I could trust, plan to rape me with someone else. It is only because I overheard one side of the conversation and the laughter that I learned of his plot. But there is another truth. If someone thought about raping you and attempted to rape you, planned it, started it, there is no escaping the fact that someone plotted to do you harm. After many years of teaching about memory, trauma, and healing, and helping women heal from trauma, I know this to be true. Survival is relative. No one except the rapist escapes being raped or survives being raped. Not you, not your community, your future partner, your children, their children, not even witnesses to testimonies. Each time we tell, read, or listen to an account, we re-experience what happened. It is, yes, as if all of us were raped again. If you have listened to this point, thank you. Obrigada, gracias, shukran, modupue, adupue. This is my story. My story defines me. I want to remember this story. It is my responsibility, the story and the retelling of the story. I tell the story to be free. I tell the story to help others get free. I'll stop there.
Thank you very much, Abegunde, for sharing that with us. And also thank you to K.H. Brower and Joan Hawkins for sharing your stories as well. An extremely powerful evening. Thank you so much for putting the collection together and for working on it too. We're gonna have a final short film from Valera DeCastro. And I wanna invite Valera back to say a little bit about this one and say anything about the others that we've seen. We kind of went for the quick transition into them, which I thought worked really well. But if you'd like to say anything about the films tonight, Valera, please.
Yes, as you see, I have my board here. I have been working on new philosophy of life, which is like life is joy. And I have been trying to go into just following my inner need of having fun. So this is another bird, and that's why this the story with the birds, the performance was, by the way, was filmed by my daughter Anita DeCastro, and the lights was also Anita's lights on. I was more free to perform. I really enjoyed that performance, and I really enjoyed that bird, that character. I edited that movie several times. It had different music, but I still didn't get to the final editing. I am in love with all those scenes and want much more that I cut, but I want to bring it down to maybe 6 minutes, and I really have something that it's powerful. The music that I chose, it's called Yurapuru, and talks about this Brazilian bird that it's in the Amazon forest. And there is all kind of legends about that bird. So when I thought about the performance, I really had one of those legends in mind. So one of the versions of those legends. And I have a website, so it's my name, valeriadecastro.com. And there you can see all the videos and all the explanation about the birds. But one, this is also an echo performance, and the Yurapuru, it's a very rare bird now, and it's in danger of extinction. So it's sad, and it's, I believe it's true, because every time that I heard a recording of the Yoruba singing, it was very clear, and there was not any other sound around it. And it is in the Amazon forest, it's almost impossible. So they say that when the Yoruba sings, all the other birds and all the other animals, they just are quiet. There is no sound. He only sings in the morning and he sings in the afternoon. And he only sings in a period of the year. It's very lucky that you can catch this little bird singing, and they call him the singer of the forest. And it's very beautiful. So the symphony was composed, inspired by this chant that it changes, and it's like a mate moment, a mate song as well. So the legend talks about this love in between the daughter of the chief of this tribe and this other one, the warrior, that it's not for her. She is too much for him because she is the daughter of the chief, and he's just somebody that it's somebody. So anyway, so he end up escaping from the chief, and he asked their god Tupan to transform him and help him. So Tupan transformed him in this bird, and he sings in a hope that his lover will one day understand that the bird is him that is singing to her. So that's a very beautiful, but also has this like a message of that this bird today is in extinction, and because of being rare, and also because people in the region believes that if they catch the bird and they embalsamate that bird and keep it, it brings good luck in love. So it's a big mess. And I think, so the idea is to bring a little bit of awareness to that issue as well. And we also saw before that, Eros and Psyche. This was a very successful work we did here in Indiana, was filmed in Indiana at the Spring Mill Park, and was part of a big performance with the choir and other artists, and later on was transformed into that film. So Eros and Psyche was inspired in the poem from Portuguese poet Fernando Pessoa, and it's something that always impressed me when I was a teenager, and always impressed me until today. So I think this performance was kind of going to passing that admiration for this poem. It's kind of letting it go in a sense. It's very deep for me because I sent it to a exhibition in Italy, and it was selected. So we traveled there and we presented also a very a short version of the performance at the premiere of the film. So anyway, this was a collaboration, very nice production. It is a love story, but it's a broken heart love story. So the music is about like Donna Desprezzata, which is the woman that was left behind. So that is the lover or the husband or whoever are left. And it is something in somehow autobiographic, because I had my first ex-husband was Italian. And it was the first time that I was going back to Italy after we divorced, and was a moment where I was showing that movie that was inspired into that theme of a divorce as well. But we have been divorced for more than 20 years, and we are great friends. But in somehow, it was kind of, wow, I'm finally artistically divorcing my first husband. So that's how I felt when we presented that movie. And so it's, I think it's pretty much straightforward, but the poem is very beautiful because it's that idea of the Sleeping Beauty and the prince, and this idea of the prince looking for that beauty, that it's princess that is sleeping. And then when he finally go through all this trouble and he gets there and he puts his hand in his head, he realized that he is the Sleeping Beauty, so the princess that is sleeping. So it's kind of a little twist on that. And that was the inspiration for that. Although I hate have to tell you that, because you never figure it out there, and that's how it's supposed to be. So, and the last one, it's also a collaboration that I did with my friends. We did this, this Eros and Psyche, and then we did a collaboration that was interesting because we had January filmed Amy performing in Irishland, and I filmed Amy performing here in a studio, and I added the video, and I put the both videos together telling a story. So was our first try out as a video art performance. And so I'm glad that was chosen for today. And that is a poem at the beginning, and I think most of you will probably know it. But it's an experience that they lived in a different country, and I put my my twist on it, my interpretation to that. So, yeah. Oh, and by the way, if you are curious about how I project and did that first movie, was very crazy. I had to lay down in my bed and then have the projector in front of me on top of the head in the stove. And so pointing with the dictionaries, and so I could have the light projecting on the screen, and I'm laying down and making a screen here. So I had to have the camera on top of my head here so I could see what I was filming. So it was an adventure, but it gives this thing of like, oh, how she did that? And that's how I did it. So just by curiosity. And I hope you enjoyed the last one.
You do not have to be good. You do not have to walk on your knees for 100 miles through the desert repenting. You only have to let the soft animal of your body love what it loves. Tell me about your despair, yours, and I will tell you mine. Meanwhile, the world goes on. Meanwhile, the sun and the clear pebbles of the rain are moving across the landscapes, over the prairies and the deep trees, the mountains and the rivers. Meanwhile, the wild geese high in the clean blue air are heading home again. Whoever you are, no matter how lonely, the world offers itself to your imagination, calls to you like the wild geese, harsh and exciting, over and over announcing your place in the family of things.
Wonderful. That was Geese, a short film by Valera DeCastro. And I want to thank Valera for her wonderful film work and for joining us tonight and saying a little bit about the films. I also want to thank our three readers tonight, Abegunde, K.H. Brower, and JOAN HAWKINS, all reading from excerpts from the book, forthcoming book, Rape Escapes. And I want to thank everyone for joining us this evening. Again, we are sponsored by the Indiana Arts Commission, the Bloomington Arts Commission, and the Bloomington Urban Enterprise Association. Join us again next month. We'll be right back here on Wednesday, May 5th at 6 o'clock Eastern, where we will observe Asian Pacific American Heritage Month, featuring poets David Mura, Anna Liu, Danny Nguyen, with music by vocalist Kyoko Kitamura. And we'll also have a short Q&A after that. My name is Tony Brewer. I want to also thank JOAN HAWKINS, who is a co-producer of this program, and Kyle Kwas, who is behind the scenes, our technical director. Thank you all for joining us. Feel free, if you're on the Zoom, feel free to hang out for a bit afterward. We will go dark here on Facebook in just a moment, but feel free to hang out for a bit with us. Everybody stay healthy, get your shots, and we will be together soon, later this year. Take care of yourselves and good night.
Thank you to everyone for coming. Thanks, Tony.